the 22nd of June, 1893, near the shore of Tripoli, Lebanon. The Royal Navy was near into its zenith. Massive ironclad and steel battleships ply the seas from Gibraltar to Fiji, but none were so vital or massive as the Mediterranean fleet. But on this day, the flagship of this fleet, HMS Victoria, would find her end, not to enemy guns or torpedoes, but to a simple navigational error and an unwillingness to question clearly dangerous orders from a superior. A bit of complacency that leads to the deaths of hundreds. The late 1800s were a definitive shift in naval conflict. The advent of the steam-powered vessel, as well as the Ironsides, leads to an entire rethinking in how naval doctrine was handled. Long gone were the days of wooden sailing vessels of the line, sailing broadside to broadside, pummeling each other to smithereens with heavy multi-gun salvos at near point-blank range. Advancements in gun technology increased that range. Advances in armor necessitated different strategies. The age of the pre-dreadnought turned naval strategy on its head, and the Royal Navy needed to be at the forefront of that swing in tactics. In 1879, a vessel would be laid down and launched in 1881. The HMS Conqueror. But even before her commissioning in 1886, a newer and more improved design would be on the drawing boards. Conqueror was an ironclad battleship who featured a bow-mounted, twin-breech loading 12-inch or 305mm gun turret. She featured a host of breech-loading 6-inch or 152mm guns, as well as a number of 6-pounder 57mm quick-fire guns. But one of the most unusual weapons, as far as today's standards are concerned, was her armored bow ram. The idea being that the 6-inch and 6-pounder guns would soften up an enemy vessel's unarmored portions, lighting fires and killing crew. The heavier guns would be used to smash through her armor, soften up her gunnery, and disable her power plant and steering gear long enough for the battleship to turn bow in and ram her, putting a huge hole in the ship below the waterline and sending her to the bottom. This was a sound design at the time, and the Royal Navy wanted to improve upon it even further. So it commissioned the construction of two more like the Conqueror, but improved upon. So after several design revisions, two ships were laid down in 1885. 13 June 1885 in the Armstrong, Mitchell & Company yards in Elswick, UK, the, at the time, HMS Renown would be built. After a few years, a full hull was launched, but really wouldn't be recognizable as the finished product. Yet being launched in 1887, her name would be changed from Renown to Victoria, in honor of the Queen's Golden Jubilee, or her 50-year anniversary of her reign. The ship was launched on April 9, 1887, and a scale model of the ship was presented to the Queen. But the ship wouldn't be completed and commissioned until March of 1890, 3 years later. HMS Victoria would be the lead ship in a class of two, her sister ship being the HMS Sans-Pareil. The vessels were nearly double the displacement of the HMS Conqueror, displacing a staggering 11,020 tons. The vessels were 340 feet or 103 meters in length, 70 feet or 21 meters at the beam, and had a 27 foot or 8 meter draft. The Victoria and Sans-Pareil were some of the first vessels in the Royal Navy to utilize triple expansion boilers, featuring a pair of Humphreys and Tennant triple expansion boilers. She was also one of the first to feature a steam turbine connected to a dynamo, supplying electrical power to the ship. All of this meaning that her twin shafts could push her along at a very respectable 16 to 17 knots. Blistering for a battleship at the time, especially seeing as Conqueror was nearly half their weight and could only achieve 14 knots. The ship's power plant produced 8,000 indicated horsepower with open draught, but up to 14,000 indicated horsepower under forced draught, meaning that a high air pressure was maintained in the boiler to allow it to more efficiently burn. It was calculated that the new boilers were at least 80% more efficient than other vessels at the time, allowing the ships to travel farther on less coal. Another marked improvement of the Victoria class over her predecessors was the armament. The main armament on the bow was initially slated to be two 13.5-inch or 340mm breech-loading guns in a dual-mounted turret, but lack of the guns caused the design to be revised into the massive two 16.25-inch or 413mm 110-ton breech-loading guns. The massive guns would become the most prominent feature on the ship, but they wouldn't be without their drawbacks, namely instability for the ship. But other issues included the fact that it took over 3 minutes to reload that enormous 1,800-pound shell after firing. The gun had an effective firing arc between 30 degrees off the bow and 90 degrees off the beam. Too far forward, and she'd begin to buckle her deck from the force of her firing, and too far aft, and she'd start damaging her superstructure. The force of the twin guns was so enormous that effectively they could only be fired 75 times before having to be rebarreled, and prolonged firing could cause the massive barrels to overheat and sag, further decreasing her already subpar accuracy. Before the days of fire projectors, a 16-inch gun couldn't come anywhere near the distance or accuracy of 16-inch guns found in the 20th century. Not even close. But all this aside, the 16-inch guns were more than enough to punch through the armor of any contemporary ship of the time. The impressive firepower would be supplemented by a battery of 12 6-inch or 152mm breech-loading guns and 12 6-pounder 57mm quick-fire guns, twice as many as was on HMS Conqueror. Additionally, to cover her aft, was a large breech-loading 10-inch 250mm gun. Both ships were also fitted with six 14-inch 360mm torpedo tubes. The armor was also improved. The Royal Navy at this time was developing a citadel armor scheme, meaning the most vital areas of the ship, such as her power plant and magazines, were heavily armored, while portions of her bow and stern were less so, allowing her to put thicker armor on but cut down on weight. This meant that her armor belt was over a foot thick, 18 inches or 46 centimeters. Her protective bulkhead sat at an impressive 16 inches or 41 centimeters thick. Her massive turrets were an imposing 17 inches or 43 centimeters thick, and her conning tower was about 14 inches or 36 centimeters thick, while her deck was about 3 inches or 7.6 centimeters thick. Meaning not only could she dish out punishment, but she could take some too. After Victoria was commissioned, she was transferred to the Mediterranean Fleet, the center of the Royal Navy's power. By late 1891, command of the Mediterranean station would be assumed by Vice Admiral Sir George Tryon, who made Victoria his flagship. Sir George Tryon by this time was 59 and was a seasoned Royal Navy man, to say the least. He became a naval cadet later in life than most at the age of 16, but quickly became known as a very intelligent man that often thought outside of the box. He served during the Crimean War before taking command of several vessels and the Australian station, before assuming the command of the Mediterranean station. Sir George sought the normal levels of obedience expected of his officers, but he also was one to go against tradition. Famously, he developed a signaling method he referred to as TA. This method did away with the time-tested method of signaling a command, awaiting a recognition of the command, before signaling for the execution of the command. Instead, the flagship would issue an order and the ships in line would simply follow the vessels ahead of them. Tryon believed this would increase the fluidity of a fleet's motions in the heat of battle and cut down on the time it took for commands to go through. But in doing this, he also made it abundantly clear that it did not remove a captain from his individual responsibility of keeping his ship and crew safe, which would come into play later. Around this time, command of HMS Victoria herself was given to Captain Maurice Archibald Burke, then age 37. He had been in the Navy for 24 years at this time and had previously commanded HMS Surprise. HMS Victoria's unfortunate and short career hit its first bump in January of 1892. At this time, the Mediterranean station ships were performing torpedo drills off Plataea, Greece. The ships were operating individually, and so Vice Admiral Tryon was not on board Victoria at the time. The ships were operating near Snipe Point, a naturally shallow area close to shore. The reason being that when the torpedoes were fired, they would run until they ran out of power, then ideally float to the surface for retrieval. But should they sink, divers could be sent down into the shallows to retrieve them easily. Captain Burke knew of the navigational hazards posed by the shallows off the point, so to minimize the risk, he sent out a crew to mark the shoal with a buoy. This way, whilst his crew was operating at speed, they could easily avoid the shoal. But the crew misidentified the tip of the shoal and missed their mark with the buoy. So while passing outside of the buoy, Victoria still ran aground going nearly 9 knots. The bow of the ship hit the rocky shoal at a considerable speed, tearing up her keel plating and sending the bow 7 feet, or a little over 2 meters, higher out of the water. After the initial shock, Captain Burke ordered soundings around the ship, finding that the stern section had around 10 to 11 fathoms, or 20 meters of depth beneath her, but there was no way the Victoria could remove herself under her own power. Three compartments had been flooded from the damage, weighing the ship down further. A nearby depot ship made two attempts to tow Victoria off at a high tide, but was unsuccessful. Finally, she simply helped anchoring her stern to keep her from swinging whilst on the rocks. By this time, Vice Admiral Tryon had arrived aboard HMS Surprise. He had ordered HMS Phaeton, Edinburgh, Dreadnought, Scout, and Humber to the scene to assist, and by this time the tug Samson was on scene as well. Victoria would be lightened by over 1,200 tons, nearly 500 of which was coal from her bunkers. Next, both Edinburgh and Dreadnought were tied off to the stern of Victoria, the ironclad battleships utilizing heavy hawser lines to attempt to stern tow the Victoria off the rocks. They threw anchors off their bow to keep them from being pulled into the shallows as well. Meanwhile, the tug Samson tied off alongside Victoria, who had thrown her engines into a stern propulsion. Finally, at high tide on the 4th of February, the Victoria was refloated, 5 days after running aground. She limped back to port in Malta to repair the 70-foot section of torn-up hull. After the repair, she continued her duties with no real other issue. Peacetime in the Mediterranean included long cruises dotted with fleet maneuvers, gunnery training, and navigational drills, what essentially amounted to busy work and shows of force. But it would be one of these simple evolutions that would lead to her untimely end. The 22nd of June, 1893, HMS Victoria had been in the fleet for around 3 years, acting as flagship for the Mediterranean. With Vice Admiral Tryon at command, he led an 11-ship fleet through a series of navigational drills and maneuvers. Below decks on HMS Victoria, those not on watch or helping with the drills enjoyed a day to relax, clean uniforms, write letters, and so on. But it was a hot and humid day. The portholes and doors on board opened to promote some airflow through the ship. Tryon's flagship sat in command ahead of five other vessels. Following astern of him were Nile, Dreadnought, Inflexible, Collingwood, and Phaeton. Directly to his port was another column about 1,200 meters distant. At the head of this second column was Tryon's second-in-command, Rear Admiral Albert Hastings Markham. Admiral Markham was aboard his flagship, HMS Camperdown. This 10,000-ton battleship was leading a line of four other ships, Edinburgh, Sanspareil, Edgar, and Amphion. The two columns steamed towards the shore in tandem at around 8 knots. This would be their final maneuver before anchoring for the evening. At 1500, Admiral Tryon passed on an order to both columns of the fleet. 2nd Division, alter course in succession, 16 points to starboard, preserving the order of the fleet. 1st Division, alter course in succession, 16 points to port, preserving the order of the fleet. This essentially equated to both columns would turn inwards towards each other, then reform on a reciprocal course, in the same formation as before, meaning Victoria's column would be to the starboard of Camperdown's. So not only would the vessels need to turn in towards each other, the columns would need to cross between each other. There was a pause from the bridge team on board Victoria to affirm that this was indeed what Sir George intended. He gave only a short affirmation. The vessels were inside of each other's turning circles, and the order wasn't exactly completely clear either. But clearly, the Admiral knew what he was doing. He was a very skilled seaman, after all. After a brief hesitation, the order was passed through semaphore to the port column, and Markham aboard Camperdown, who was equally confused. But the shore of Tripoli was looming ahead of the fleet. Taking time to decipher or question the order just wasn't viable. Impatiently, Admiral Tryon signaled Camperdown, questioning the hesitation. "What are you waiting for?" Surprised to be embarrassed in front of his subordinates like this, Admiral Markham ordered his crew to commence the maneuver, turning to starboard towards the opposite column as Victoria turned port to do the same. The Camperdown and Victoria were now in a direct collision course, and everyone on each bridge seemed to know this. The officers later admitted they had expected last-minute orders from Tryon that simply never came. As if in slow motion, the vessels turned in towards one another, moving at a slow but steady 8 knots towards each other. Admiral Markham recounted that he had believed Victoria would overtake his stern, and that he didn't dare to alter course for fear of maneuvering into her path. If he turned in, he risked cutting her off. If he widened his turn, he risked running right into her. As far as what Tryon had in mind, we'll likely never know. At 3 minutes after the initial order to turn, the vessels bore down on each other. Captain Burke, aboard Victoria, asked Tryon 3 times for permission to go astern, the Admiral only realizing at the last minute the error in his order. He gave the orders to go astern before shouting across to Markham to go astern, go astern. Camperdown collided with the Victoria around 60 to 70 feet after of her bow. Despite Markham ordering astern propulsion, only 3/4 astern was given, and the ship was still going a solid 6 knots when they collided. Both ships shuddered as Camperdown's ram smashed into the lesser armored bow of Victoria, 9 feet below the waterline, followed by a decently large portion of her bow. The force and momentum of the blow causing the ships to twist and rotate, only enlarging the gash left in Victoria's bow. Tryon not only seemed shocked, he didn't seem to grasp the weight of the situation either. Whilst Captain Burke went down below to assist in closing off watertight bulkheads, Admiral Tryon warned away other vessels in the column that avoided the colliding battleships by only 100 yards or so. He ordered them not to lower boats to assist, instead ordering Victoria to turn in toward shore to beach her. By now, Camperdown's astern propulsion pulled her away from Victoria, causing water to rush in at an alarming rate, the bow of the battleship acting like a shoddy cork for a time. The sudden inrush of water would quickly overwhelm the men attempting to close off bulkheads. Water pouring into over their heads as they scrambled to close bulkheads, fleeing spaces or risking drowning in them. On deck, several men attempted to wrestle a collision mat to place over the side of the ship to cover the hull, but the heavy device was abandoned as water started to slip over the low freeboard of the ship, and they were now standing in water. The bow dipped below the water by 5 minutes after collision. The ship began to list heavily to starboard, water down flooding from the gun ports and the massive turret as the turret became the only visible part of the bow above the water. Compartments flooded one by one as the hydraulic systems failed. The ship lost steering and the ability to lower boats. After 8 minutes, the bow was submerged and water was to the main deck. The engines were still turning, but the screws were nearly out of the water. After failing to close the bulkheads, Captain Burke made it topside and ordered the crew to fall in. With them assembled, he ordered them to turn towards the rail and abandon ship. Men leapt into the water and swam for their lives as water began to rush into the secondary armament gun ports on the main deck, hastening the list of the vessel. There was a sound of crashing as the list caused anything not tied down on the ship to tumble to the starboard side. The ship lurched and quickly began rolling over as the bow sank. Men trapped in the engine rooms went under still at their posts, never receiving the order to abandon ship. Water entering the engine rooms detonated her boilers in a horrible explosion. With the stern sticking straight out of the water, screws still spinning, threatening anyone in the water around her, she plunged below the surface, creating massive and horrific suction that dragged down swimming men into the depths. Admiral Tryon was last seen standing upon the chart house, his last words being, "It was all my fault." With him went 358 men. After this incident, news of the event reached the UK, but gave very little details. Thousands of angered family and friends laid siege to the Admiralty, demanding answers, the Admiralty only giving the names of the 22 officers that perished. How could an entire battleship and so many sailors be lost in a peacetime training accident? As more information became available, they began to wonder why experienced officers would follow such a dangerous order. A court-martial began to try and ascertain the cause of this tragedy and who was to blame, the public being very displeased upon the Admiralty laying full blame upon Admiral Tryon, despite Admiral Markham himself even feeling guilty for not questioning the order. The Admiralty insisted that he did the right thing by not questioning anything. A lesser tragedy of this event being that Victoria was in active service less time than she was being constructed. Her 8 years of life, she was being built for 5 of them. Queen Victoria would outlive the namesake vessel by 8 years, passing away in 1901. A very interesting note on this ship is the discovery of her wreck in August of 2004, in 460 feet or 140 meters of water. The Victoria is sitting completely vertically, her nose section buried into the soft mud bottom as her propellers point straight up to the surface. Her nose being driven down and wedged into the bottom due to the heavy weight of her bow, coupled with the force of her still-spinning shafts motoring her down to lawn dart into the bottom. She's one of the only major wrecks found to be this way and is now a very popular diving spot, the pictures of her wreck offering an eerie and fascinating image to look at. HMS Victoria was a ship cut down before her prime, a massive weapon of war that never was to reach her full potential due to blind obedience to orders from a man who made a terrible and life-destroying mistake. She would forever stand as an example of why discipline is important, but the ability of a military man to question dangerous orders wasn't just a good trait, it was necessary. Thank you so much for tuning in to another episode. I hope you found this one just as interesting as I did. It was a sort of quicker one to get the ball rolling again in 2022, and I have some other exciting videos planned to really get this year started with a bang. It's wild for me to look at just how far this channel has come in just 1 year. On the 10th of January, it'll have been a year of creating content for me. Very awesome, I have all of you to thank for this. I of course want to thank my patrons, Wesley Simmons, David Wilson, Celine McRae, Francis McCarthy, Grumman Wildcat, Aaron B., Brandon Coyle, Sarastro, Castnewt Brophy, CinemaScoped, Mike, Peter Lawler, David A. Chauvet, Matt Bloom, Chris George, Mr. E. Meat, or Mystery Meat as people pointed out, and Fred Benson. Of course, half of everything I get from Patreon goes to the Gary Sinise Foundation, so I thank you, and I'm sure they do too. One last thing for you. If you're going to donate to the Patreon, I greatly appreciate it, but I implore you, please, instead, go out, take that $5, go to your nearest museum ship or museum, what have you, donate it to them. This past week, I was in Fall River, Massachusetts. There I got to tour the incredible Battleship Cove and see the mighty USS Massachusetts in person. Walk her decks, stand where brave fighting men and women stood before, and really see history firsthand. That's an incredible experience and a very expensive one to maintain. They need all the help they can get, way more than I do. So I implore you, donate to the real historians before donating to some YouTuber. If you want to help me out or help the channel, like, comment, and subscribe. Share it with your friends. That's all I have for you today. Have a happy new year and fair winds and following seas to you, shipmates.